We're finally wrapping up our NFL Combine coverage. Joe DeLeone, Ryan Roberts here on the NFL Believe in NFL Draft Prospects podcast. It's been a bit of a long weekend, a long week for Ryan, who was in Indianapolis. A lot of coverage to get to. We're going to be talking about offensive linemen and running backs to round out this last show. Probably going to be one of the shorter shows of the cycle of this long weekend because we only really had two position groups. Ryan, I want to start off, though, and it was something that we were trying to figure out who to talk about amongst the offensive linemen. And I feel like it's one of the few years where we can put together a list of like 10 guys. And there weren't that many offensive linemen compared to other position groups. There were like 10 guys that I thought tested well, looked really good in the drills. It feels strange saying that. Now, I think that a reason for that is that this tackle class actually has some decent depth. I think it's got some decent talent at the top. It's deeper at the top than I think some people are willing to give it credit for. There is a bit of a cascade, if you will, of where the talent does start to drop off toward day three. But I think there's some sneaky good guys that showed up today that we're going to end up talking about here.
Well, Joe, I think I've been pretty consistent with this since the summer. There's not really, in my opinion, a true top 10 player in the offensive tackle group. You know, like there's guys that are going to go that high, but I wouldn't grade them out that way. But what you have here is, especially at offensive tackle, there's a lot of tools to work with, man. I mean, we can go from day one to day two to day three to priority free agency territory. We can find traits to work with. Like, it's a very gifted offensive line group. I don't think it's incredibly refined all the way around, especially near the top. Like, I don't think it's incredibly refined. But, I mean, we're going to be talking about a lot of dudes that absolutely lit it up from an RAS perspective, from a, you know, testing perspective, just in general. Like, guys that really put their best foot forward and tested as great athletes, which you know they are. And I know that a lot of offensive line coaches in this class, specifically at offensive tackle, they're going to look at this class and say, yeah, there's not a lot of finished products. There's not a lot of guys that are near their ceiling, but I can get the most out of that guy, right? Like, why wouldn't I want to work with Paris Johnson, for instance, right? Like, why would I not want to work with Blake Freeland? Like, there's so many great talents in this class that I think a lot of people are going to be excited about.
I also feel like most draft classes, once we get into the second round, it's really hit or miss. And very rarely do guys drafted in the second round typically pan out. But I think that this is going to be one of those classes where we're going to have a Matt Bergeron. We're going to have an Osiris Torrance. We're going to have a Steve Avila, who I like, who I don't think you like as much, or even a Blake Freeland, who could end up being long-term starters in the NFL. The one guy, Ryan, that's getting a lot of varying conversations is Peter Skoronski. And I want to talk about him first because physically he shows up with everything you're looking for, except for one thing. 6'4", he's 313. He's got 32 1/4-inch arms. That's where the red flag is. He still runs a 5.16, which is a good time. He has a 34.5-inch vertical, which is a good vertical, and then 9'7" broad, which is a good number for the broad. So this is an explosive guy. We knew that this guy had power, and he's an explosive player. We also knew that he moved really well, and we saw him put that on display. I mean, my man put on a clinic with the way that he was moving during these drills.
Yep.
Here's where I stand on this, and I think that I'm a little bit – I agree with you, but not as much, I think, as where you stand.
Okay.
I'm willing to test Skoronski at tackle, but I at the very least believe that he is an all-pro guard. And I said that in the summer, that if he doesn't work at tackle, he's going to be an elite guard. But I'm very wary of putting him at tackle. I'm very wary of it because that length stuff sometimes shows up on tape, and now we have a number to go beside it.
Yeah, I mean, half of what you just said, I think we actually agree with 100%. Like, I literally put in a tweet today that, I mean, yeah, he has a great baseline because he could be a really good guard at the next level. Like, at worst, I mean, he could even play center, right? Like, he could play both guard spots. He could play center. I think he could play both tackles as well. Joe, I'm just this is a nuanced conversation because you mentioned the arm length. But the one interesting thing is that he has broad shoulders. So he actually came in with right around an 80-inch wingspan. So he doesn't have like terrible length from a full radius perspective, right? Like he's on par with the Matt Bergerons of the world when it comes to wingspan, right? So I think that the arm length in a vacuum worries me. But when you kind of put the full context of, but the fact that he has broad shoulders, he actually has a little more range than maybe you would just anticipate by 32 and an eighth inch arm or 32 and a quarter, whatever the heck it ended up being. And the one thing that has me betting on him, outside of him just being a really nice, technically sound football player, is you hear me talk about this all the time, Joe. When someone lacks in a certain area, what do they need? What do they need? Overcompensating traits. And what did the testing show us today? Testing showed us that he has really nice foot quickness and he's got some explosiveness to him. That's what he has. So yeah, he might not have the arm length that you would want ideally, but I just think that there was just so much good film there, man. And he's playing against the Ohio States of the world. He's playing against the Michigans. He's going against these long athletic pass rushers that are going to play in the NFL. I mean, I remember the 2021 film that I thought was his best all year was against Michigan. He had a great outing against Aiden Hutchinson and David Ajabo and those types of dudes who are legit NFL rushers. I mean, Aiden Hutchinson just had 9.5 sacks as a rookie. Like, he's a good football player, right? So I look at Skoronski and I say, I understand it. And typically, I'm a big traditionalist with arm length for the most part. You know, like, yeah. I look for that measurable. But for me, I look at him and I say, yes, he doesn't have great length from an arm length perspective, but he's got other overcompensating traits, the technical side of the game, the range that he has from a foot quickness perspective. I think he's a tackle. And if I'm drafting him in the top 10, someone said this on Twitter, I agree completely on it. If you're drafting him in the top 10, you're drafting him to play tackle, man. You're not drafting him to play guard. If you think he's just a guard, you're drafting him more in the Zach Martin range of number 16 overall, right? Like, that's kind of my thing, is that I think he's a tackle. I just really do.
Well, Quinn, the only thing that I get, because I agree with all that, I just get slightly hung up on pointing to like Quentin Nelson as an example, who he's a big guy. He was 6'5 and change or whatever he was, did not have the arm length, and he's an all-pro guard. He's the best guard in the NFL right now. And he was drafted in the top 10. So like, that's where I kind of get mixed up, where I don't know if I draft him in the top 10, I need to put him at tackle. That's where like I'm coming from, and I think that's the small 5% we disagree on.
But you're talking about Quentin Nelson, who was a generational guard. Like, he was the best guard we've seen come out in 15 years, 20 years. Yeah. Like, it's been a long time, man. If you're drafting Skoronski to play guard, it's still a little bit of a projection because he's never played guard before, right? Like, it's a Zach Martin thing.
That's true.
That's why Zach Martin went 16th overall. It was because you thought Zach Martin could be a really good guard, but you never seen it. He was a 4-year starter at left tackle at Notre Dame. Like, it was a little bit of a projection. I just think that for me, like, Skoronski does enough outside of the arm length where I'm like, that's a tackle, man. And yeah, if it doesn't pan out, he's a really good guard, though. Like, there's a baseline there, but I feel like I'm going to miss on him if I say that he's just a guard. I feel like I'm going to miss. So I'm going to keep it open. I'm going to keep the option open. If he goes to a New England-esque type of scheme that says, like, we don't care about length as much, right? We don't care about the height attributes as much. We just care about good football players. I really think Skoronski could be a good one at offensive tackle.
And maybe that is the Las Vegas Raiders. Maybe that's where he ends up, which is a, to your point, a New England-esque scheme, quite literally with Josh McDaniels being the head coach there.
And they certainly need offensive tackles in LA.
Oh my God. They need it bad. Yeah. They need it bad. And there are still other options. I see this other clump grouping of guys that are going to be scattered throughout the first round and early in the second, who I noticed really good performances from. So Broderick Jones from Georgia, who I just finished grading before the combine. I saw everything in the workout that I saw on tape. Little green needs to improve a little bit more. I think needs to add a little bit more weight to his upper body. At 6'5",
you know what's the craziest part about him, Joe? And you saw it. You see it on film. You saw it when he tests. He always keeps that base, man. Like, he's got that wide base. Like,
yes.
He looks like a guard, but then he has good foot quickness and stuff. You're like, all right, maybe he can play tackle, right? And then he runs like 4.9, whatever, in the 40. You're just like, hey, he's a good athlete. But he just kind of plays the position like a guard, which is just kind of interesting. Just a little bit for me.
That's a funny way to look at it. But the base thing to me is what I loved. It's 6'5", 3'11", 34 and 3/4 inch arms. So stupid length, 4.97, 30 inch vertical, 9 foot broad. Very, very easy mover. Matt Bergeron doesn't run his 40. I'd put him in this grouping as well at 6'5", 318, 33 3/4 inch arms, 30 inch vertical, and then 8 foot, 7 inch broad. The last one here, that I think also fits this grouping, who I think is probably going to go the first amongst this clump, is Paris Johnson, who at 6'6", 36 and an eighth inch arms, my God, at 313, doesn't really do any of the other testing, but very light. The only thing that bugged me about Paris Johnson is how narrow his base was on a lot of the drills. I didn't feel like I was getting him kicking and stepping and planting as much as I felt like he was shuffling, and I didn't like that. That bugged me a little bit, but he's very light on his feet, so I'm not that worried about it because I know at the very least you can clean up those steps because he's making a transition. He's transitioning to tackle right now.
Joe, in the history of the combine, there has been five players that have had 36-plus inch arms, okay? Five football players. Two of them played offensive tackle for Ohio State this past year. Wild, man. Joe, I mean, honestly, if you're asking me who am I betting on to be the best tackle this year in the 2023 NFL draft, it's Paris Johnson, man. It is. Like, that kid's a freak show, man. I mean, there's the best way to put it. Like, I didn't need him to run a 40 to know that he's a freak show because you saw him move in space. You saw him go through the drills. And you're just like, that kid is one, just a massive human being, right? Like 6'6", 320, whatever the heck he was, you know, kind of weighing in. But with those 36 plus inch arms, that kid just has a frame where you're like, that kid could put on another 15, 20 pounds and still hold it easily because he's just got that type of just big frame, you know? Like, he's just massive everywhere there. And then you see him move and you're like, it just looks so natural for him. You know, he looks like he's been
playing.
He's
like a basketball player. Yeah. Is kind of the way he moves.
He does look like a basketball player. You're not wrong there, man. Like, he's just got really quick feet. He's very coordinated, which is very important at the offensive tackle position. He looks really good. I would say the most impressive part about Matthew Bergeron is kind of the same thing, though, is that he looks so coordinated as a player, right? Like, when he was going through those drills, he looks so balanced. He doesn't ever look like he's false stepping. It doesn't look like he's off balance at all times. Like, he just looks so controlled as an athlete, which is just really, really impressive, man. So this group of, you know, I mean, Paris Johnson's a first-tier offensive tackle in 2023, right? But the second-tier guys of the Broderick Joneses, of the Matthew Bergerons, there's a lot of tools to work with, man. Like, no exaggeration. If I was a team late first round or maybe even mid first round into the second round, I would be chomping at the bit to work with some of these offensive tackles, man, because it's pretty deep, man. I mean, there's going to be some people's lists, I'm sure, that don't even have Matthew Bergeron as a top five offensive tackle, right? And there's just going to be some. And it's not that I'm disagreeing with that take too much. It's just that there is some depth here, man. Like, there's a lot of dudes to work with. And, you know, I think it's just a testament to the overall talent of the group. But, I mean, Bergeron, again, like, just moving, being able to shuffle and backpedal and do a lot of type of stuff. Like, he's just such a natural, man. There's just a lot of coordination and a lot of balance in this group overall.
Before we continue on with this video, I just want to tell you folks about an exciting new partnership that we have with this channel, with Underdog Fantasy. Ever since I joined, I've been having so much fun. There are so many different exciting games that make watching games during the offseason more exciting. I'm not the biggest basketball fan, but it has made it way more entertaining since I found Underdog Fantasy. And my favorite game to play so far, which I think you should try out, is Pick'em. It is so easy to play. Just pick higher or lower on your favorite player stats, and you can win up to 20 times your money in a single night. Underdog keeps it simple. With their easy-to-use website and mobile apps, pick between 2 and 5 players to fill out your Pick'em slip, get every pick right, and take home some cold hard cash. Use code HACK, H-A-C-K. Hack, like the name of this channel. Use code HACK to get your first deposit doubled up to $100 by Underdog. Go sign up. You won't regret it. You're going to have a blast. Check out Underdog Fantasy. I also want to tell you folks about our other reoccurring sponsor that we have on this channel, that being BetOnline, betonline.ag, which has all the updated odds, news, and anything for sports betting. It's my go-to source for when I want to be betting specifically on games. I love betting on college basketball or the NBA, especially again during the offseason. Always looking for more fun ways to be focused in on some of these other sports. It's betonline.ag and use promo code BELIEVE50. It's promo code BELIEVE50 to get 50% welcome bonus on your first deposit. BetOnline, where the game starts. We have to give a quick shout out to Blake Freeland, who did come on the show. So go check out that really old episode that we had with him. 6'8", 302 pounds. 33 7/8 inch arms, which is kind of weird. He's so freaking tall, but he's got for proportionally kind of has T-Rex arms, but still
T-Rex
good, like,
arms. Those got 34. Stop.
All right. I'm talking about proportionally, like for a guy who's 6'8", you'd think he'd have 37, 36 sure. inch arms, but he doesn't.
Sure.
4'9" in the 40, which is stupid. 37 inch vertical, which is stupid. And then 10 foot broad, which is dumb stupid. So this is an explosive athlete, played other positions. The only thing that bugs me with Blake Freeland is everything that I've said about the guy on tape is that he's too damn high, and I don't see a guy that can sink into his hips very well.
Yeah.
I'm still hung up on him, and I think that's going to probably keep him out of the top 10 or maybe at the very end of my top 10 tackles. But there's a lot to work with, you know, take him somewhere on day 3 and
yep.
If he's a backup, he's a backup. And
ooh,
if
day 3, really? Day 3, you think, huh?
Early day 3? If you can get him to work on his hip flexibility and get him to sink into his hips a little bit more, I just think it's so easy to say Blake Freeland is going to be good because he's tall, he's got the length, he moves so well. But then I always get with these tall, long guys, and I've seen it from college to seeing these prospects where if they can't get low, and you're going to get beat. That's where I'm getting a little hung up.
Well, with some power rushers at times, yeah. I mean, the counteracting power is the biggest question mark that you have with Blake because he just doesn't have – I mean, he's 6'8". You said it already, right? Like, he's a high-cut kid too. Like, he's got high hips. He's just not a guy that's comfortable bending a ton. But, Joe, and we talked about this before, you know, about his athletic background. I mean, this kid was an all-state javelin thrower, 180-plus feet. He was an all-state discus thrower. Like, he is a freak show of an athlete. Came as a tight end recruit to BYU, was only 260 pounds, has obviously grown into that frame over the last few years. I just want to buy into him so bad, Joe. I really do. I think he's a late day two player for me. Like, I would draft him in the third round. Really? I would, because I think he's got so much developmental potential, man. I still think there's a lot of Colton Miller there. We're not talking about a good athlete. We're not talking about a great athlete. He tested as an historical athlete, Joe. Historical. And he has a lot of good tape at BYU in pass protection. Run game needs to improve. There's no doubt.
Yeah.
But there's been a couple guys that I can look at and say they had similar issues and they were able to overcompensate in other areas and be really good players. Like Colton Miller is the guy that I've compared him to a ton. Colton Miller coming out of UCLA was 6'7" and a half, had trouble bending, but he was a great athlete. So you're like, he could probably figure it out. Another guy, Joe.
Colton Miller went in the first round, though.
I'm not saying to take Blake Freeland in the first round. Blake did not take enough of a step this year for me to get comfortable in the first round. We talked about that in the summer. I thought he could make that jump. He didn't make that jump. It was still good film. Wasn't great film, though. Wasn't great in 2022. But I think that he has similar traits to a Colton Miller. And I also would say this is it was the Oakland Raiders that drafted Colton Miller in the first round. No other team was going to draft Colton Miller in the first round. But it happened for them that it so happened that Colton Miller ends up being a good football player. He's a good left tackle in the NFL. The other guy I've seen him compared to, which I think is really interesting, guy that you know, and your reaction is going to be like, oh, this guy. Nate Solder is a guy that there is some comparison there. Because I know in the Giants he wasn't very good. But when he was on the Patriots, he was an excellent left tackle. Very good left tackle. And there's just – but he had the same thing, man. He was like 6'8", long, had trouble bending. But foot quickness, athleticism. Those.
I feel like he was deceptively good. And that was kind of the issue when he was with the Giants is that he was so high that he always had bad leverage and then he would get beat. And that was why it was so frustrating to watch him as a player. I get so wary with that stuff, man. I think if you can't sink, you can't sink. Some guys just are not. It's not like he's not a fluid athlete. That's not what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's just if you can't get into your hips and you're bending at your hips instead of sinking into them as an offensive lineman, I get so hung up on that. I can't explain. Actually, I can explain it. If you can't get low, you can't get low. Low man wins.
You just need to he needs to do some more yoga, man. That's all. He'll be fine.
But Joe, honestly, I'd send him to do that seriously.
Joe, at the end of the day, though, man, we have seen great. Why do we talk about relative athletic score and that type of stuff all the time? Right, the testing. It's because usually the really good athletes find a way. Like usually that happens, man. There are obviously some combine freaks where you're like, you know, that guy's just looks like Tarzan, plays like Jane. That happens all the time. But Blake Freeland did have some good film at BYU. It wasn't like he sucked, and then he just came to the combine. It's like, oh, man, what an athlete, right? Like, that's not what happened here. So I think there's developmental potential there. I really do.
I want to give some acknowledgement to some interior guys really quickly that I thought did well and tested well. Steve Avila, I know that you're not as big of a fan of him, but, dude, his feet are just so powerful. I watching him move back and forth at 6'3", 332, man, I think that he's a good, strong kid. And 5'2", 1's deceptively good number for his 40 time. I think I would have assumed he was going to be slow as all hell, but he ends up moving well. Cyrus Torrance, 6'5". 33 7/8 inch arms, 330 pounds, 5'3", 1 in the 40. I think that both those guys, really powerful players. The one I want to talk about to just wrap up the offensive lineman, though, and you were tweeting about it, and we're in the same camp. Ricky Stromberg, the good hate player, for man. Ricky Stromberg does not make any sense to me. It doesn't make any sense to me. He's 6'3", 306 pounds, 33 1/4 inch arms, so he's got better length than I thought actually he would have. 5'2", 6", 32 1/2 inch vertical, 9'3" on the broad. And you know what? Watching him on these pull drills, watching these on the screen drill that he did, him moving downfield is so natural. And that was what you got from him on tape, is that in a zone scheme, he is going to transition and move so freaking easily. We're overthinking him, man. We got to stop overthinking Ricky Stromberg. He's a four-year starter. Is he a four-year starter?
Four-year starter, yeah. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Four-year starter.
Well, three and a half, but yeah, still same.
Yep. But we got to stop our overthinking him, man. It's ridiculous at this point.
I don't get this one, Joe. Like, I've talked to a lot of people about this. I haven't found one person that I've talked to that's like, I didn't really like him that much. I'm just like, everyone I've talked to that has watched Ricky Stromberg likes Ricky Stromberg. Like, I'm confused on it, man, because he weighed in good. Like, he's got good size. Length is fine. Like, you know, cool. Checks all that boxes. He's a good athlete. We obviously saw that today. He had good film. Playing the SEC. Multi-year starter. I'm just confused on it, man. I'm very confused on it. I mean, I actually did get a tip. I forgot to tell you this one, but Ricky's dad actually messaged me because he knows I'm a fan of Ricky, and he told me that he was going to test really well. Like 2 weeks ago, he was like, yeah, Ricky's going to open some eyes. Like, yeah.
That's great.
And he did, man. He looked really good. And then the best part, though, is that, yeah, he ran a solid 40, and he did some good stuff with the jumps and all that great stuff. But in the field drills, shined, man. He's a really efficient athlete. He has good flexibility for an interior offensive lineman, good foot quickness. And I think he's got power through his hips, and I think it's still developing. I think he's got more room to grow there as well. I think he's a starting caliber center at the next level. And I've heard that the latest, you know, when I talked to Ricky's dad a couple weeks ago, was they were hearing like early day three, like round four-ish type of
feedback.
Yeah, like round four-ish type of feedback. But they had kind of through the grapevine, if he had a good combine and stuff and a good East-West Shrine game, he was probably going to be more in like the third round type of conversation. So I think he's a late day two player, but man, I think he's a starting center no matter where he goes.
Look, I like John Michael Schmitz, and I'm also a big fan of Luke Whippler and Joe Tippmann. I love all of those guys. But I think Ricky Stromberg takes the positives of John Michael Schmitz, which is the experience and the awareness. And he takes the positives of Tippmann and Whippler of athleticism and movement skills and strength. It doesn't make any, he's Creed Humphrey. You said that already on this show. He is Creed Humphrey. Plain and simple.
Yeah. I think that there's, you know, maybe he's not the flashiest player on film, so like some people underrate him a little bit, but he's just so efficient, man, and he just is such an all-around good football player. Like, there's not many holes in Ricky Stromberg's game. Like, he's just, you're like, okay, pass pro, he's good at that. Run game, he's good at that. Plays with good leverage, cool. Moves to second level well. Has a power profile. Like, I just don't know what I'm missing. Like, I just think that he kind of checks a lot of boxes. Maybe he isn't elite in any area, but he's good in a lot.
I also think, too, and just to round out the point on him, I also think he's got pretty good displacement power. Like, I think out of most guys, I think he's up there at the top of the centers. I think he's got really good displacement power, which is important and underrated. I don't understand why more people aren't excited about stuff like that.
Someone, I forget who it was, but there was someone on Twitter that I respect, but I can't remember who it was. I just remember this clip coming up where it was the Texas game. And by the way, if anybody wants to know why I'm so big fan of Ricky Stromberg, go to the Texas game this year. Like, that's one of his better games.
Yeah. The Alabama game too. Very good game against Alabama.
And he took the nose tackle from Texas that was here this week. 99. I forget his name. The 6'2", 330 pound kid. Whatever. Doesn't matter. Joe, he was in a zero on him, right? Head up on the center. And he took my guy and he obliterated him, drove him about 6 yard back and planted him in the ground, man.
Forklifted his ass. Is that what you're telling me?
Dude, he put him in a casket, man. Like, it was really bad. I'm trying to find, it's going to bug me because I know his name. He actually had a decent combine. Keandre Coburn. Yeah. He's 6'1" and a half, 332 pounds. And he literally put my guy in a grave on that play. Like, it was just fantastic.
That is fantastic. A guy on Texas, though, that was not getting his ass kicked, who was a monster at the combine. Bijan Robinson, to start off our conversation of the running backs, we've got four guys that I think I want to get to here. Yep. Bijan, without a doubt, we have to discuss. And 5'11", 215, 4.46 in the 40, which is not Saquon time, but that's still very freaking fast. 37-inch vertical, 10'4" on the broad.
Yep.
Plain and simple, like, I don't think there's anything overcomplicated to evaluate with Bijan, man. He looked the most natural, explosive. This is a top 10 back. This is a guy who's going to be a top 5 back in the NFL the minute he steps on the field. Plain and simple.
Joe, let me choose my words carefully here because I know people like to misconstrue and they like to put words in mouths. He's the best football player in the 2023 class, regardless of position. And again, I'm not putting positional value because obviously I'm not drafting a running back over a really good quarterback, for instance, right? Like, I'm not doing that. Mm-hmm. But man, like, what's the hole in his game? Tell me what the
There's
hole
not.
Is.
I want to hear there were guys tripping over the bags during these drills and just looked really clunky as all hell. But Bijan, man, just like, to your point, I didn't see a bad rep once catching the football, moving over these bags, reading those various holes where they had to read and then cut and then get upfield.
Yep.
There was no adjustment in terms of like having to accelerate, none of that stuff. He is, like your point, there are no holes.
It really isn't.
I don't think anyone's overthinking him, though.
Yeah, no one is overthinking him. I think the battle that people are having, though, is how high am I going to draft a running back, right? Like, that's the conversation that people are having. At 215 pounds, I think he has good vision. I don't think he has great vision, but it's good. It's not a detriment in any way. The kid's explosive. The kid's powerful. And by the way, did you see him in the pass catching drills, man, where they ran like a Texas route and he stuck his foot in the ground and accelerated out of it? It's just rare, man. It's rare. Goofy. Like, he's just good at everything. He really is just good at everything.
Jahmyr Gibbs also looked goofy in those pass catching drills. Jahmyr Gibbs is also going to be problematic in the NFL for different reasons. This is Alvin Kamara. This is Jamal Charles, as you said, 5'9", 199. He runs a 4.36 and then a 33.5-inch vertical. Explosive. So explosive. I love Jahmyr Gibbs, man. And I saw everything that I knew. Flexible, easy, fluid athlete. He just moves like it's nothing, man.
He's a special athlete, man. He really is. I mean, Joe, I literally posted a thing where I was talking about him in August of 2021, man, talking about him already. Because I remember, I think they had an offensive tackle that year that was a Vanderbilt transfer. I forget his name, but he was playing left tackle. I'm just like, who the heck is this kid at running back, man? He was like a freshman or a sophomore at that point. You're just like, what? I guess he was a freshman at that point. You're just like, what the heck is this? Like, what am I looking at right now?
How did he end up there?
Exactly. Like, and then you look and you're like, he was a top 100 recruit. Like, literally, how did he end up here? I don't know why he went to Georgia Tech. I know he's a Georgia kid, but like, why would you go to Tech? But he ends up obviously at Alabama, man. And you see the dynamic element that he has. And whether you want to compare him to Alvin Kamara or Jamal Charles or whatever, all I know is this kid is lightning in a bottle. And I mean, in comparison, Jamal Charles ran 4.38, and Jamal Charles was one of the better home run hitters that we've seen at running back in the last 10 years, right? Mm. He ran faster than him. Jahmyr ran faster, 4.36, man. Kid is going to be an absolute weapon on the next level. The question that people are going to have, and it's a fair one, is this an every down running back? Can he carry a full load as an every down runner? Can he do that? It's a fair question. It's fair because he's a little smaller, right? It's
I don't know if you really need him to, though. Like, I don't know if I
need him to. You don't need him
to. I don't want him to be a 300 carry guy. I want him to be my primary back, and then I rotate somebody else that's a little bit thicker, like a Zach Charbonnet. Obviously, they're not going to be on the same team, but I see him as the secondary, not as the primary punch to a good duo.
Yeah.
That's what I see Jahmyr Gibbs. I see 250 touches, not carries. That's what I want from Jahmyr.
Yeah, and he's just, man, he might be the most fun film I've watched this cycle of.
That's why I like him so much.
I mean, Joe, he does some unnatural stuff, man. I mean, he averaged over 12 yards a catch in his career, which is just a wild number for a running back. So, you know, running option routes, running wheel routes, running routes out of the slots, running inside zone, running outside zone. This kid's a home run waiting to happen, man. Get this kid in space, manufacture some space, and just let him go. Because the rarest thing that we saw, and you know, the 40 times great, and that's all well and good and expected, right? I thought he was going to run 4.4 flat, give or take two hundredths of a second, excuse me. Obviously, he runs a little better than even I thought he would. But ultimately, what makes him so special, though, is that when you saw him in the drills, he changes direction and doesn't have to slow down, man. He accelerates in and out of every cut he makes. That's what makes him special in the open field. The fact that he could change direction with such incredible pace, man. There's some fast guys that really have to motor down to kind of change direction and do that type
like
of stuff.
Like A-chain.
Yeah. He does not – Jahmyr Gibbs doesn't have to slow down, man. Like he doesn't lose any RPMs while he's trying to change one direction or the other. He's just special athlete in space, man. Special athlete.
Two last quick nods before we wrap here. Deuce Vaughn doesn't really do he doesn't run a 40, so we don't have a 40 for him. Mighty Mouse, short king Deuce Vaughn, flew during the drills. We saw similar things to Jahmyr Gibbs, where he doesn't have to really shift down, and he's just a very easy cutter, very easy mover. I saw really good hands from him.
Yep.
I'm still on the Tyjae Spears train, man. I feel very confident after the way that he looked, putting him in my top five. The way that he stacked up against some of these other clunky dudes who were struggling during these drills at 5'10", 201, 10-inch hands, by the way, which is a good
Spears
number. I like
Spears it. Spears 10-inch hands?
10-inch hands, man. He's got some mitts on him. He can catch the ball really well for a reason. 39-inch vert, 10'5" on the broad. That explosive numbers are fantastic. I wonder what his 40 is, and I guess we'll see at his pro day.
It's probably 4'5", flat, yeah. 4'5", 2", something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he is the epitome of consistency in my eyes, just a simple, easy mover. And again, I thought that he stood out amongst these group of guys, and I feel very comfortable putting him in that top five.
Yeah. I mean, Spears has really, he's had one of the best draft processes of anyone so far this cycle, man. He really has. I mean, he's gone from, you know, fun player at Tulane, great story on a really good team this past year, to turning into legitimate NFL prospect at the running back position. I think the things that we harp on, what gives him such a nice baseline is that, yeah, maybe he isn't a 250 plus carry a year guy, but he's going to be a guy that can affect the game in space, right? Whether it is as a runner in the passing game, he has that baseline, which is exciting. Deuce Vaughn, Joe, Chris Deuce Vaughn. I struggle with this stuff sometimes, right? Because I am a traditionalist. I do think that thresholds are important from a size perspective. I do.
Yeah.
Deuce Vaughn is one that I'm just throwing it out the window, man. I'm saying, like, I don't care. Like, that film is just too good for me to say, like, but he's 5'5". Sure. He's 5'5". He's also not going to be a 250-plus carry a year guy. But that kid's lightning in a bottle, man. He's going to be a good NFL player. Whatever role that ends up being, we'll see as far as what the fit is, who drafts him, all that great stuff. But this kid is going to be a dynamic weapon in a role in the NFL. Like, there's no doubt, man. He's just too athletic. He's too fluid. He's too instinctive. There's special there, man. I really think he's special.
This is cliche, but I bet he's a Denver Bronco.
Putting like that into a Philip Lindsay type of thing?
No. I'm saying he's
Sean Payton,
man. I think that's where he's going to land. I really believe that I'm willing to bet, and I'm hoping that Sean Payton is thinking to himself, Like, what are the odds the second team that I end up taking over, there is a Kansas State running back that is tiny and that is a problem if we put him in space? I think you draft him in the third round and you get yourself a really nice added weapon to the mold.
You know what I think is going to happen, Joe, actually, is that, you know, the Chargers are going to draft him, and then Sean Payton's going to sign him as a free agent after he plays with the Chargers for a couple years. Because that would actually be the Darren Sproles trajectory, right? That would be the Darren Sproles trajectory. But to your point, man, hope he gets with creative offensive coordinator. I really hope so, because this kid could affect the screen game. He could run some stuff out of the slot. He could be a running back, obviously. I would love to see him as a punt returner. I would love to see it. I think that he is an all-around weapon. You just have to understand that there is going to be some limitations with him just from the size perspective, but there's no limitation to the impact that he can have as a football player, man. He's special in that regard.
Good note to wrap us up on at Joe DeLeon, at Rise and Draft. We'll be back during the week with more NFL draft coverage. Hopefully you enjoyed our combine recaps.